morning, friends. A special welcome.
Yes, I hear you're all about.
Hi, Miss Mark.
Good morning, friends, again. A special welcome to those of our community joining us on the World Wide Web.
But before I start, I must say something about those two plants there.
They are actually Reverend Elma's. She sent them down to us, well, after she left. And they were a little raggy, but Sean and Marshall, especially Sean, brought them really back to life. So, loving hands. Loving hands. Yes. Let us begin with St. Luke chapter 18, verse 1 to 8. And I quote, "And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Saying, there was in a city a judge, which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said? And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth?" End of quote. My question to each individual in this room is, what is standing between you and the vision of how you want your life to be? Or, what would you do if you were guaranteed success? I'll say them again. What is standing between you and the vision of how you want your life to be? Or, what would you do if you were guaranteed success? I want you to stop and think for a while. I am asking if you can fast forward your mental pictures to one where you are living the desired vision of your life. What does it look like? Feel like? Or, I am doing what I have always wanted to do. What does it feel like? What does it look like? That successful, happy, fulfilled, joyful vision picture of yourself. Just feel the feeling. Bask in it for a while. That successful, happy, fulfilled, joyful vision of yourself. Threaded through that experience, does these components fit in it? Are you accomplishing things that touch your heart, stimulate your mind, interests? What qualities are you expressing when you are engaged in what you love? Are you touching the lives of others? Does this make you feel good inside? Fulfilled, satisfied, contented? My opinion is, if you are still on this plane of existence, then there is always the infinite possibilities of you expanding into that vision and to encompass more. If you are still here, there is more work to be done, there is more life to live, there is more to enjoy, and just know that wherever you are in this moment, you can be more of that self.
that you were created to be.
Dr. Holmes reminds us that it is okay to dream and dream big. He says, here's the difference between the dreamer and the practical man. The dreamer is always floating around in the clouds. The practical person keeps their thought in the clouds and their feet on the earth. In this way, they bring heaven to earth through themselves. This is necessary. Let us keep the dream side open, as it is the beautiful side of our nature. It is the meditative, contemplative side, the subtle side, forever merged with the universe, and it is at one with good. Since this inner self is in continuous connection with the outer self, it can cause a flow of intelligence, stimulating the mind and brain to purposefulness, to creative genius, to executive ability, end of quote. So if we need guidance on moving forward with our vision, the new way of being, if guaranteed success, or if there are those long buried dreams that we felt our advice could not be accomplished, then stop and think about it. We have just completed a series of classes based on the story of Lazarus of Bethany that spoke to the resurrection of long dead visions and dreams that we have buried under tombstones with the epitaph, "Rest in peace, no longer possible, impossible to manifest." I tell you, friends, the manifestation of those long buried dreams are indeed possible. In fact, Dr. Holmes gave us an affirmation that fits, and I quote, "Let the infinite intelligence within me acquaint my mind, tell me what to do, that it may come forth into perfect expression. Let the infinite intelligence within me acquaint my mind, tell me what to do, that it may come forth into perfect expression." He reminds us again that because we are limited is no reason why the universe should have limitation. Our limitation is only our unbelief. Life can give us a big thing or a little thing. When it gives us a little thing, it is not limited any more than life is limited when it makes a grain of sand, because it could just as well have made a planet. But in the great scheme of things, all kinds of forms, large and small, are necessary, which combined make a complete whole. The power and substance behind everything remains infinite. Now this life can become to us only through us. And that becoming is the passing of spirit into expression in our lives in the form of the thought we give to it. In itself, life is never limited. An ant has just as much life as an elephant. The question is not one of size, but one of consciousness. End of quote. So friends, we must give to the creative mind each day a new and greater concept of ourselves. So how does the story of the importunate widow fit into this? Jesus, the way shower, starts off with the phrase that men ought always to pray and not faint. The importance of prayer in the manifestation and demonstration of the good desire cannot be disregarded. The metaphysical aspects behind the parable then amplifies the significance of the concept of persistence in prayer. The meaning behind the widow is ideas that accept duality and self-imposed limitations, which are adversaries to the implementation of our purpose of expressing and experiencing the new vision of being, having, and doing. Duality in the sense we are aware of the machinations of the law. We know the law of mind work.
But there is no effort in aligning our consciousness to what we truly desire. And there's always dissonance there. The word importunate means very persistent, but it was taken from a Latin derivative that means inconvenient. So when one moves ahead, focused on achieving the good desire, it is no longer convenient to keep the old way of thinking, speaking, and acting. It is no longer convenient to keep the old mental patterns and expect something different. It is no longer convenient to want a new vision to manifest without changes. It's no longer convenient to emphasize what we do not want, but to confidently move towards what it is that we do want to accomplish. The judge is the law. Therefore, the individual seeking relief from self-imposed restrictions or limitations, which are indeed adversaries to the new vision, must be very persistent to the point of sometimes feeling inconvenience. Because this is what happens when you are changing a new mental pattern to what is aligned with the new way of being. It is inconvenient sometimes to get up in the morning when you want to stay sleepy and not do your practical spiritual work. It is inconvenient in the middle of an argument to ask for guidance rather than shut your mouth. It is inconvenient to hold on fast to old paradigms that just don't serve us. We have to let go to encompass something new and something different. In the parable, the judge stated, "Though I fear not God nor regard man." In other words, it's the impersonal law, no favorites. It works the same way for everyone. "Yet because the widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me." So by persistently placing the new idea in mind, it must manifest to the point of being weary. Our prayer must therefore be one of total acceptance of the new vision of ourselves. It already is, or we could not provide the blueprint of this new way of life that we want to sense and feel. We accept it, and with gratitude, see it appear in our lives and affairs. Because that's how our prayers are already answered. Our declaration of principles inform us why the law will manifest and support our intention to move towards the purpose of living a life of joy in the constant expectation of increased good. The first principle is we believe in God, the living spirit almighty, one indestructible, absolute, and self-existent cause. This one manifests itself in and through all creation, but is not absorbed by its creation. The manifest universe is the body of God. It is the logical and necessary outcome of the infinite self-knowingness of God. Self-existent, it becomes the thing it is expressing. Life can become to us only through us, and that becoming is the passing of spirit into expression into our lives in the form of the thought that we give to it. What self-knowingness means? The characteristic of spirit is intelligence. It knows, it knows, it knows. It's infinite. So anything you give it, it knows how to do it, how to bring it about. You don't have to worry. You don't have to give God any instructions. In fact, I remember reading somewhere, Craig Carter said, all you have to do is just listen and follow the instructions. You don't tell God what to do. He knows. We are surrounded by the creative mind, which receives the direct impress of our thoughts. This is how God works. This is the law of God. So Jesus of Yeshua can say that God avenged his own elect, which cried day and night unto him. I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. In other words, our persistent prayers are individualized expressions, creations of God, which will be dealt with speedily. So men ought always to pray and not faint. So what is standing in the way of achieving our purpose, of experiencing this vision of our lives as it was intended to be? The demonstration of long-dead desires of increased good in our lives. It is not the law, but our use of it. Since purpose is the why, then the possible answer is the execution of the way forward. So how do we do this? We adopt a new strategy with a method which resonates with us, which we will persevere with whether or not it is inconvenient. In fact, that is no longer relevant. We are working towards complete fulfillment. We embrace a new set of values in line with what we want and expand our self-awareness. We monitor our growth and unfoldment. The vessel of our consciousness must be refined and expanded to facilitate the new concept of our life's experience. If you are expanding the volume of a metal vessel, don't you knock from inside? It is much the same with us. We work from the inside. We are required to develop new talents and abilities in order to execute our purpose. Robert Bitzer states, and I quote, "Our consciousness is the way and the key to our demonstration. It opens our minds to limitless possibilities. We must know where we are going and why, and depend on a guiding intelligence to get us there," end of quote. It takes organization of our mental attributes to implement our strategy with conviction. We must therefore act with authority. This authority is based on our inner self-knowingness and the conviction of the truth of our being, one with God. One of our New Thought writers states, "Within you, the one mind reveals to you what you need to know about yourself and what you need to do." So we can speak our word then with power and in command of every set situation. Men ought always to pray and not faint. Our last class last Thursday was titled, "Cherish the Gift. How comforting it is to know that the universe can handle every situation. Indeed, there is nothing that is impossible to achieve." We grow in grace and love as we continue to do the inner mental work through our spiritual practices, whether by prayer, affirmations, meditation, contemplation, whatever works for you. We embrace wholeheartedly a life that is a blessing to ourselves and by extension the cosmos. We engage in our life experience from a position of worthiness and deservedness. Life is defined by our courage and integrity to fully express at every level of our consciousness. Because we know we are guided from within, we are not attached to persons' approval or the dictates of the exterior world. We are empathetic without judgment. We form deep connections to all who people our world. We are leaders and mentors because responsibility is not onerous or fear-filled. It is a pleasure to give of our talents, expertise, and abilities. We are able to cultivate authenticity, self-love, a resilient spirit, appreciation, and respect for others. Joy is natural to us as we are able to attract all that is necessary for us to experience well-being. We are intuitive and exemplify the faith of God. We are creative, attracting meaningful work with appropriate remuneration, because the universe is our employer. Calmness of spirit, peace of mind is a way of being. And yet we are spontaneous. Like Liam, we laugh, we sing, and dance to the rhythm of life. Friends, this is the evidence of our inner work on our consciousness. As we move methodically to that true vision of life as it was intended to be. So I remind you, as what Jesus the Yeshua said, men ought always to pray and not faint. So what is being suggested? When we need guidance on what to think, say, or do, I picked up some advice from one of our daily guys in this month's Science of Mind magazine. It says, you begin with a centering breath, a deep centering breath.
Remind yourself that you have got this. Whatever it is, you have got it. And you really do. Every time you go into prayer, you're not doing it alone. You are partnering with God to create the highest and best life you could possibly dream of. Every time you go into prayer, you are in partnership with the creator of universes, infinite possibilities. So you can go in with a mood and an attitude. I've got this. I can do this. I know this. I am guided. And stand firm. Men ought always to pray and not faint. So affirm with me now, and I'll read it. Let the infinite intelligence within me acquaint my mind. Tell me what to do, that it may come forth into perfect expression. So, I'll say it for you. And you close your eyes. And I'll say it in a half voice. And then we end. Let the infinite intelligence within me acquaint my mind. Tell me what to do, that it may come forth into perfect expression. In a half voice, let the infinite intelligence within me acquaint my mind. Tell me what to do, that it may come forth into perfect expression. So it is. But you're going to hear something that will allow you to sing along.
Morning, everyone. It's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful day to be alive. Come together. Thank you, Uncle Mikey, for inviting me. The word. The word.
I can see clearly now the rains. I can see all obstacles in my way. Gone are the bad clouds that had me blind. It's gonna be a bright, sunshiny day. Gonna be a bright, sunshiny day. Oh yes, I can make it now the days. All of the bad feelings have disappeared. Now here is the rainbow I've been praying. Bright, sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, sunshiny day. Look all around, there's nothing but blue sky. Look straight ahead, there's nothing but blue sky. I can see all obstacles in my way. Yes, I can make it now. All the pain is gone. It's gonna be a bright sunshine day. It's gonna be a bright sunshine day. Let's stand and do this. It's gonna be a bright sunshine day. It's gonna be a bright sunshine day. Bright sunshine. It's gonna be bright sunshine day. Boom, it's gonna be a bright sunshine day. I smile like this, 'cause when I hear the sermon, when I walk in, Uncle Mikey knows the story. He was there crying the tears with me. And now I'm really here to just sing a song. But I have to share this testimony. Last year, Uncle Mikey. Yes, sit. Feel beautiful, brother. Last year, March, the month I was born, strange things started happening to my body. I did an EP launch in pain. Nobody knew me. I kept it a secret. I was exercising. I was running up and down because I believed I only had gas because I wasn't eating properly. On the 31st of March, I did a CT scan because 4 years earlier, I was diagnosed with colon cancer. So on the 24th of March, when I did my CT scan, I had stage 4 colon cancer. Metastasized to my lungs and other places. And I kept it quiet from Uncle Mikey and a couple other people who are my closest families, but not friends, families. He heard, and he decided to come and visit me. And he spoke to me, and he said, no, we need to let the world know what is happening here. And he started all the groundwork. Himself, Tamara Williams, and a couple other people. I was so angry. At who? I don't know. But I was so angry that I threw my fish tank halfway across the room. I took up one of my TV and threw it from one side of the room to the other. Because I've decided that my life was now over. This was it. And no one was going to touch me again to do another surgery on me in Jamaica. Because I was angry. Uncle Mikey knew my anger. A lot of people knew my anger. And I was walking around with it. And I had anger years before that. Today I'm alive. Today I'm alive. A lot of people wrote me off as dead.
including myself, wrote off myself as dead. We do that a lot in our lives. Not physically, but sometimes mentally, we write off ourselves as dead. When it's just another obstacle to jump over. A lot of people used to call me and tell me, Denver, look at your tall man. You can just jump over the hurdles, you're good. Uncle Michael says, son, you're going to be all right. Don't worry about it, man. We're going to make sure you're all right. I remember going on Facebook for the first time and I cried for 1 hour. After my friend, some Ashi, came to look for me and said, Denver, so we used to come here. Ashi, we used to be here in the early days with Mr. Joseph Robinson. And he always taught us about our faith. God rest his soul. And Conroy Wilson came to my house and said, You know what does that mean? Fix it, because you can fix it. You know. And he gave me a book to read. I called another friend of mine and he asked me some questions. And I got up and I burned every single pillow in my house. That was my first sign of cleansing. Right after I burned those pillows and buy some new ones, I felt anew. I started reading my Bible and praying. Went to Mexico. They taught me spiritually on another level. They did the surgery. And the doctor says, healing is in the mind. We did what we can do. The rest is up to you. It's gonna be a bright and shining day.
Well, we must give thanks that we had two sermons this morning. One from Reverend Frank and